Mr. Deputy Speaker, I have great pleasure in taking part in the debate relating to the demands for grants for this Ministry of Home Affairs. The Minister of Home Affairs occupies an important position in the Central Executive, and the Central Executive under the Constitution is vested with wide powers. It is because of the wide powers and the unique position under the Constitution that it is able to hold the country united in spite of various diversities of language, religion, and other things. Therefore, this unique position should not be disturbed even when we think of amendment to the Constitution at any time. The Home Ministry had a difficult time during the year in retrospect. The whole country was in turmoil politically and economically. The articles of consumption were scarce, prices were soaring high, and there was large-scale black marketing and smuggling. And in this turmoil, some opposition parties, I do not say all the opposition parties, but some of them campaigned civil disobedience in the whole country from the 29th June and paralyzed the government to subvert democracy and the Constitution. This act of the opposition cannot be accepted by the present government. Any government worth its name had to prevent it and to take effective steps to bar such a move, and this law, which was proclaimed by the president on the advice of the government, saved the whole country from destruction. It is no good complaining that during the period under review, civil liberties are curtailed, democratic rights are abrogated, and so on. But who is responsible for this? As my friend who has just spoken said, that they were responsible for creating such a situation. Freedom of speech, freedom of realization does not imply unrestrained freedom or unrestrained rights. Where there is a right, there is a duty. Every right has to be exercised in such a way that it does not cause any hardship to the other who has the same right. It is no good complaining. But let us see the results that accrued from this period. There is all around discipline. You now find discipline in the house. All the members are highly disciplined. They are speaking within their limit, and the work is going on according to the schedule. There is no backlog. I am very happy to see that emergency has produced the desired effect even on members of parliament. We face a changed situation. I am told, and I hope this figure is correct, that since 1962 there has been only a 5% inflation in the voting, and yet it has created a tremendously changed picture. We are today not only in the government but in some states in the opposition. We have to create and we have to show good standards of democratic functioning. We have to deal and work with the opposition wherever they work for the good of the country, whenever we feel that they are going in the right direction. We must not oppose them merely for the sake of opposition, as sometimes we ourselves have been opposed. In our organization, we must renew our faith in the path of democratic socialist functioning. I do not want to go at this time into matters of policy. We shall have many occasions to discuss these matters. Today I should like to welcome all those who are new members. We welcome them here and hope that they will make valuable and interesting contributions to Lok Sabha and that they being here will enrich our party. At the same time, I should like to give me good wishes to those who will no longer be with us. They have been valued colleagues. They have played a very significant part in the debates in the house and in the functioning of the party. We shall miss these familiar faces, and we hope that no matter where they are or what work they are doing, their advice will always be available and that they will keep up their interest in the affairs of the party. Much work has to be done, not only in the legislature but at all levels, and this again is something which we must all work out under the guidance of the Congress president and other leaders. When I got up, I had many things to say to you, but I must confess that I am so moved that I have no words really except to thank you once again for the confidence which you have placed in me. I should like to tell you that this burden is a tremendous burden, and it is a burden which cannot be borne by one person alone, not even by one person and a few colleagues in the cabinet, but by the entire party here and the entire party all over the country. We must treat these problems as our problems. As I said, we have made a good beginning. Let us not hesitate to give advice or suggestion. Let no one feel isolated.